Oh, yes, we're on.
We are in.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Guff Yu-Gi-Oh! 500, where your cast is Dan and Lincoln. We're just about to start round one. Lincoln, do you want to tell everyone a little bit about today's event? This is sort of a bit of a new thing for Yu-Gi-Oh! In Queensland and Australia.
Yeah, no, definitely. It's definitely a new thing for Yu-Gi-Oh!, especially in Queensland. I'm not sure how it is in other states, but it's the first sort of highest level event that actually has sort of a real prize outlet rather than just... Most places only do like a box, maybe two if you're extremely lucky for your first place at events. I mean, I know people who've won regionals and gotten four packs. So having an event like this, which we're going to try and run every few months, that has a really high prize pool is really nice. You know, it'll bring some more competition out our local players.
Just makes it a little bit more worthwhile sort of playing Yu-Gi-Oh! In those sort of in-between formats. For people who may or may not be aware, Australia is sort of like... maybe one nationals, maybe a YCS every year if you're lucky. So sort of like compared to America where you can sort of do a YCS every month, definitely like a lot less big competitive Yu-Gi-Oh!
Oh, absolutely.
Awesome. So without further ado, we'll see what's going on our feature match table. Cool. So it
looks like the game has started already.
Yep. So it looks like we have Sean Murphy versus Hayden Matthews.
Yep. And Sean Murphy's playing, looks like what he always is, in Lightsworn. He top 8ed our Oceanics qualifier with this deck, so very familiar for him. Losing to the based Jono Ritzau in top 8. From him describing that match, Jono had everything and he had nothing.
Well, he's versing Hayden Matthews today, who is known for having everything at all times.
That's his middle name right there, Hayden Have Everything Matthews.
Or just Hayden Matthews.
Yep, see, and there he goes. He's... I believe playing his own take on Sartellas.
Yep, I'll just see if I can grab at his deck list here. He's sort of deviated from the normal Sartella Knight strategy of just sort of grinding advantage and spamming at rank 4s and gone for something a little bit different.
Well, that's just Hayden's playstyle in general. I mean, he's a good friend of both of ours, and he's been known to make a lot of off-the-wall decks in the past.
So this version of Sartella Knights, in addition to the normal Sartella Knight engine of sort of Deneb and Altair, is also running... two Alsem. For those of you who aren't aware, Alsem is the one who, when summoned, inflicts 1,000 damage to your opponent. And a large variety of burn spells. So Battleguard Howling, which is a new card from Duelist Alliance that burns your opponent when one of your warrior monsters is targeted. Sartella Knights obviously all being warriors. So I think his strategy is basically to be able to consistently put monsters on the board, as most Sartella Knight strategies do, but then going in for that direct damage rather than the attack, which does help to mitigate a bit of that attack restriction from Altair.
Absolutely. So it looks like here we've got Hayden breakthrough sealing the Raiden, trying to slow down Sean as much as possible. So Sean's hand looks to be a Soul Recharge and Honest, because he always has it.
He's got the Eclipse Wyvern as well, which is good. It means he can make a really strong Xyz play here.
Oh, most definitely.
The Eclipse Wyvern triggering anyway it goes to the grave means it's a very, very strong card, especially if you get Xyz with it. Being able to do stuff like make a little Vol Chain, detach it to send another one, and triggering both effects is really excellent.
Plus, it just lets him get some early beats down so we can just let his OTK, even if he has... See, from Hayden, we see the one of Magic Cylinder in his deck here.
Yeah, you can see the Magic Cylinder. Sean probably definitely not expecting that one at all.
Absolutely not.
And it now just means that now he's sort of aware, I guess, of like the niches in his opponent's strategy. He's going to have to... Basically, it's a bit of a mind game. He now has to play around it constantly. Like, he's never going to know now if he's going to swing into a back row, if it's just going to, like, inflict major damage to him for no real reason.
Oh, absolutely. So, Sean Murphy opting not to make a rank 4 here, which is kind of interesting. I'd expect he'd want to get his engine going. Maybe just even to Lavaval Chain stack Lightsworn Monster just to guarantee to get this... Oh, I apologize. He has a charge coming off Goldsock, so that's not going to be a problem.
Yeah, that's very nice, actually. The charge is like... It's been limited for a long time, but it really is one of the strongest Lightsworn openings. Like, anytime you're playing Lightsworn, your opponent just sort of drops the charge turn one.
Yeah, I mean, if they open one or two spells that they can actually just use, they usually get into a very good position because it just snowballs very, very quickly.
Yeah, you end up just drawing solo recharges off recharges and stuff like that, and it's pretty great. So him seeing that in sort of two turns from now is going to be a real swing and advantage for him.
Absolutely. Yeah. In saying that, I mean, Hayden has had a very reasonable start in his Rota, Deneb, Altair. But is he just going to Rhapsody, or is that Cowboy?
Yeah, that's an early game Cowboy.
He's just going in here. All right, from what I understand, my partner Gumby needs to do a judge ruling. Unfortunately, He is the only sanctioned judge at this event. So this early game cowboy is fairly interesting. Maybe he has a hand just absolutely full of burn. Or he feels he's not going to be able to push damage through easily enough just with his monsters. So he's just going to try and burn him out. Also of note, it's a warrior for Battle Guard Howling, so that's kind of interesting as well. So we have the Radin mills, Lila, and... Oh man, that was an exceptionally good mill for Hayden Matthews. Sorry, for Sean Murphy. Hitting two Lights, One Names, and a Felice. So it's interesting to see what he might do here, whether he'll try to... He just opts to pass the turn, I think. Nope, I can't see. Okay, so he's charging for the Lumina. So from this point, he has a few options. He's likely going to try and use his extra deck to push through some back row just to make sure that his major plays later actually resolve. So I wouldn't be surprised with either maybe a Direwolf or a Lavaval Chain here. Both would make sense. So he has to go for the Lavaval Chain. So he can either send another Wyvern, he can send a Dragon Ruler to make sure that he can actually trigger his Wyvern and add his fatty dragons, which is really what he wants his game plan to be.
The early game Cowboy has been an interesting play. Something that a lot of players probably don't really take into account about Cowboy is it has that 2400 defense, which is really strong, especially against something like Lightsworn, where you really need to get like a Dragon Ruler or a JD to get over it.
Oh, definitely.
I mean, most players sort of go into the card as like the last thing they do in any given game. Like, they just swing in for like that extra 800.
Yeah, and that's usually what the extra deck slot's there for, just to cheese people out after your OTK didn't quite get there.
Yeah, but being able to just sort of make it and be like, okay, cool, well, this is another 1600 burn that effectively cost me nothing to make, and I'm just going to sit on it as well, is like really nice.
Definitely. I mean, he couldn't really attack that turn anyway because of A, the Altair, and B, he didn't want to just send the Wyvern for free.
Yeah, I guess he has a real advantage against this Lightsworn deck in that he sort of, his game plan doesn't necessarily require him to attack whatsoever. So if Sean's sort of just putting Lightsworn on the board in the hope of getting names in the grave, he might find himself just sort of getting cheesed out by that burn.
Yeah.
Hayden can effectively just make Xyz and loop Alsam like over and over again just to inflict that constant burn for free, which
and
is really
like
nice.
That's probably what his game plan is going to be.
Yeah.
Also, Cowboy's a warrior for the Battle Guard Howling.
Yeah, that's really nice.
Which is definitely cute. So as we mentioned earlier, it seems like Sean has done the old recharge into recharge.
Yeah,
which
he's
is pretty nice.
90% of his deck is now in the grave, kind of,
yeah,
deck, which is exactly where he wants to be.
And now we have the board almost entirely clear and the Lumina coming down. So it seems like Sean pretty much would have this game on lock. He can get rid of the other back row. In saying that, though, I don't think he's managed to hit an elemental dragon yet, so it's likely he will not actually be able to just get these Wyverns to...
Yeah, it's one of those things, like, Lightsworn, when it works, it works. Like, if you hit the two Eclipse Wyverns and the Ruler straight up, you're sort of just able to grab those JDs really quickly. But quite often, you'll find that you'll brick because of the maybe three parts of your engine you need, you just don't see one of them. Oh, he does
he
have the title engraved,
yeah,
though.
Yeah, definitely. So this game's super over.
Yeah, he's in now. Yeah, you can see the player scooping up there. Once the JDs come down, it's kind of GG.
Have you got... Sean's list for me?
Having a dig through for Sean's list.
So we got Hayden's here?
Yeah.
And so let's have a quick look at Hayden's sideboard. So his sideboard is 2 DD Crow, 3 Typhoon, 3 Emptiness, 2 Black Horn of Heaven, 2 Shadow Mirror, a Soul Drain, and 2 Needle Sealing. So there's actually a very large amount of reasonable cards here could bring in for this matchup. The Crow's pretty obvious. Even Emptiness is fine, though, you know, very beatable.
It's sort of I always struggle with Lightsworn and Vanity's Emptiness only because, like, it stops plenty of things. It stops the rulers, it stops the Lumina.
Yeah.
But really, the JD is what you're worried about. And
absolutely.
It doesn't stop it unless you flip it preemptively.
Exactly. So you pretty much just have to flip it in their standby phase and pray they don't just hard have the Wyler or a way to search for it.
So Sean Murphy's made the very standard Life Swarm play of side decking three Royal Decrees, and he's also siding three MSTs as well, and a Malkat. So it's basically just a lot of stuff. Like, against Light Swarm, the really easy answer is to just side in a whole bunch of Floodgates.
Oh, definitely.
But if you can just sort of counter side for that, you're pretty much good.
Yeah, the Decree is going to be insane in this matchup.
He's also running two Stygian Dirge, which we've seen as like a, it's very much taken off as a side card, what with both Satellanites and Burning Abyss being very, very reliant on sort of making one rank of Exceed and having an entire extra deck of that particular rank and then just spamming that over and over again. If you can drop the levels of all their monsters by one, quite often that's enough to just put them on a full tilt where they're just unable to make any sort of Xyz at all.
Yeah, and looking at Hayden's list, let's see if he actually does just have the rank 3 in there. And no, he doesn't have a rank 3 to preempt the Stygian Dirge as it was. So for Hayden, he's likely to bring in the Crows, the Soul Drain, and either the Emptiness or the Needle Sealing. Either would be fine, but not stellar, since it's pretty easy for them to just sort of sandbag the Wilder until they need to go off.
If I am siding the Blackhorns for other matchups, I tend to take out the Solemn Warning for a Blackhorn, only because the amount of times I've lost to Warning the first JD, and then it puts on exactly 6k, which is exactly enough for the other two to go through.
Oh, that does make a lot of sense, yeah. Blackhorn is also quite good here.
Yeah, it effectively stops everything you want it to stop, but without the life point cost, which against Lightsworn can be really important, considering that sometimes...
I don't mind keeping Warning in my deck just for the Lumina plays.
Yeah.
It can be really good for them. You know, they summon the Lumina, they discard as cost. They don't always have a great hand, so the card they're discarding, they might actually, you know, have to want to keep.
Yeah.
So it's not always a Wyvern or a Lumina play going through. It could actually be a real card.
Mm. Interestingly, Sean is siding one Necroface, which I imagine is just against decks that are going to try and banish a lot of his cards. I can't imagine he'd be using the secondary effect to banish it, to banish top five a lot.
Yeah, I don't see that coming up.
No.
I mean...
it's a very unusual choice. I imagine his logic behind that would be quite interesting. Alright, so play the Shopping Life game 2 now. It's good.
I mean, Sean's a stun player, so he might give more respect than most to people just banishing him out of the game.
Yeah. Sean, being a veteran stun player, also gives him the ability to know how to play around Floodgates properly, which is really good. You'll quite often see him making very, very conservative plays that might appear suboptimal, but it's very much in the back of his mind that if he runs into a Solemn Warning or if he runs into a Vanity's Emptiness, that can sort of just lock you out of the game really quickly.
Absolutely. In fact, I think every single game I've ever lost against Sean was him just, you know, banish a set 5 or Thunderbird Garden for set 4 go. It's just very much his playstyle until he picked up Lightsworn and had a lot of success with it. All right. It's going to be interesting here to see play draw. I would assume Hayden would be very much in favor of going on the play in this matchup, simply because you just want to aggressively shut down Light Swarms as much as possible. That's how I've always wanted to play against them anyway.
Light Swarm are an interesting case. A lot of people say that sort of the theory behind play draw is if you're playing a combo deck, you want to go second, you want to see the extra cards. But with Light Swarm, even just summoning a Raiden turn one and making zero other plays puts some 4 cards in grave and just puts them really, really far ahead.
Yep. And
Hayden Matthews showing the stream camera that he just natty has the honest, because of course he does.
Hayden have everything Matthews.
Yep. Signed by one Carl Wiedemann, I believe. An honest man for an honest card.
Very much so. The Wiedemann's always giving you a little bit extra.
So, importantly, both players able to play honest. There's a lot of mind games going on, most likely, in terms of attacking. But as we mentioned before, the important thing is that Hayden's game plan doesn't necessarily require him to attack. He really does have sort of a dual strategy where he can honestly just go in for the beatdown with the Satellanites, and that's not a problem for him at all.
Absolutely.
Or if his opponent just sort of walls up with a big monster, he can just go for the burn.
So Sean Murphy's doing something rather nice here and forcing for the Wolf just to play around the Satellanova Alpha. So Hayden would have to waste the Alpha on the Wolf trigger just to like cycle. Or he gets to... and here we see the Battle Guard Howling, which is just going to strand...
So, Battle Guard Howling is a really, really interesting card from the new set. It basically, anytime one of your warriors is attacked or targeted by a card effect, you're actually able to bounce one of your opponent's monsters back to hand. It doesn't necessarily have to be the monster that can attack. It can be any monster. And you also inflict damage to them equal to its attack. So.
Yeah, and that's the really important part, Battle Guard Howling. There just really isn't that good of a way to play around it, because you can't just attack with one of your... less good monsters to play around the bounce because they can just target anything you control and get rid of it.
Yeah, and additionally, it's one of those cards where, you know, it's a combination, honestly, of Compulsory Evacuation Device and Ring of Destruction, except obviously it only hurts your opponent. So it's honestly a banned card and a limited card all in one.
With the obvious drawback of being quite situational.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, when you're running a deck full of warriors and you put them on the field, it's very much a case of, like, how do you get rid of a defense position Gaga Cowboy without attacking it or targeting it with something? Like, it's very difficult. And if you just let it sit there, then obviously he just gets to generate that incremental advantage.
Absolutely. And Sean having an interesting four Lightsworn, just setting four. And I did manage to see a Stygian Dirge there, so he's obviously brought that in. So he's going to take 1,000 from that's an Elslam, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely.
I'm not very familiar with that card's art. So there's the Stygian Dirge, which is going to shut Hayden off his extra deck.
Yeah. The decision to not run a rank 3 may have sort of put him on the back foot a little bit. Although it does become the issue of what rank 3 do you go into that actually helps your game plan. You can't run so many that you're relying on your opponent to flip the Dirge, but at the same time, there's not really a good card that just straight outs the Stygian Dirge either.
And if I'm playing Lightsworn and I flip a Stygian Dirge and my opponent makes a Zen Mains, I am so very happy with that because they're giving me so much time to just put half of my deck in my graveyard and just kill them. And getting rid of a Zen Mains in Lightsworn is just trivial.
Yeah.
Because, you know, between Michael and Big Eye and just attacking it three times, I mean, you can get around it very easily.
Even, like, if you're trying to OTK, putting a JD on the board and paying three times is not completely out of the question. Because, I mean, if you're going to kill him, the 3,000 life points is completely negligible.
Very true, very true. Also, what's kind of funny about Sean's hand right now is it's just a Felice and a Wolf. So it's very possible he's just going to die to the beats.
Yeah, that's one of the real disadvantages with Stygian Dirge. It puts your opponent off their game plan, but you really do need that follow-up. If you flip Stygian Dirge and they say, okay, I can't Exceed, that can sometimes be to your disadvantage because instead of taking 2,500 from a Deltaros every turn, you're taking like 18 from an Urukunlai and 18 from something else, and you're actually taking a lot more damage than you would have.
Yep, and there's Hayden with the fat drop of the Honest, just completely putting Sean Murphy out of the game.
Of course he had it.
Oh, of course he had it.
All right, so it's interesting to see that Hayden actually managed to win that game post-side. Anytime you see someone playing a really innovative build like Satellanite Burn or something like that, generally their advantage is in game one when their opponent's sort of not 100% sure what they're playing. Quite often, you know, you'll see the Deneb and think, okay, this is Satellanites, no worries. They set the five back row. Suddenly it's like a ceasefire, a just desserts, and a battle guard howling, and you just
get burned out of the game.
You're just dead before you know what happened.
He might alpha your first play, and then next turn it's like Vega into, what do you call his name? I've always called him Ukulele. I don't know what his actual name is.
It's like Unakunlai, I think.
Unakunlai, okay.
Yeah.
I'm probably just going to call him Ukulele all
Look,
day.
By guessing that almost correctly the first time, we're officially better than actual R&D, so that's good. But yeah, that's kind of the deal. Like,
the interesting thing I really like about Hayden's deck as well is he can just side his burnout game too and have his opponent constantly playing around it and making plays to preserve their life total that they probably just don't need to make because he may not even have the burn in his deck in game two. I mean, he clearly kept the Alsams in, but
yeah,
I mean, Howling's a good card. Otherwise, he can just cut the bad cards like Just Desserts and Ceasefire. And
yeah, it definitely does make sliding for him very easy. If he's seeing that, you know, he's playing a deck where his opponent's like something like Bujin, where they're likely to just put one monster on the field and leave it there,
yeah,
then taking out their Just Desserts that's not going to do a whole lot and just straight siding in Floodgates means that he's basically got like a 30-card core engine that's really solid, and he doesn't have to interfere with that at all to side.
So one card we didn't talk about from Sean Murphy's side is the Quackimiro Drago, which is actually going to be pretty great if he manages to land it. Yeah. 1,900 beats over all the Satellas, and he can't touch a lot of his good options. You know, he can't Ukulele Call the Haunted, which is a very solid opening for Hayden. He also just shuts off his Altairs, which will just shut off a lot of his extra deck plays.
Yeah, it does look like he's drawn it as well. Oh, he's siding it. Yeah, I think he is siding in the Quackimiro Drago. And obviously that card sees a lot of play in Dragon Rulers now with Stolz, Burning Abyss, and Stellanites. But interestingly, Lights won't actually run a high enough Dragon count. The one copy is definitely worth
absolutely.
It.
Absolutely. I mean, you can just, most of the time in the early game, the Judgment Dragons and the Diabolos in your hand aren't going to be doing a whole lot anyway.
Yeah.
And so letting your opponent just know it's coming, you're going to lose to this.
Yeah, that's it. And again, that sort of mind game play, like a lot of Yu-Gi-Oh can be, you know, trying to keep information from your opponent. But sometimes when they know you have something, it actually makes it a lot worse because they end up trying to play around it so hard that they just fall into other traps. Yeah, so just see if we can pull up Draugr here and just get its full effect.
There we are.
So yeah, as you can see, it does require you to reveal a dragon or send an Iron Core from your hand to the grave. Most people don't run the Iron Core, but between the three copies of Eclipse Wyvern and the three copies of Judgment Dragon, normally around two Light Red Abalos and all the Dragon Rulers, you definitely have enough targets.
You'll usually mathematically have at least one of those copies in your hand.
Interestingly, it has a good interaction with Tempest as well, if Sean's running that.
Sure, but I mean, is he going to have any way to actually banish it in his deck?
Oh, well, I mean, like, if he ends up with a Tempest and a Dragon Ruler and, say, an Eclipse Wyvern, he can, like, banish the Tempest for the Dragon Ruler, get back the JD, and add the Draugr, which is nice. Obviously,
that's true.
Most players don't rely on that sort of play, but it's always nice when you banish a Dragon Ruler and you're able to just say, oh, yeah, and I also just get this guy for free. That's nice.
Yeah, and it'll play around a lot of, like, the alpha and such. I mean, you don't really just want to alpha a Dragon Ruler summon. So he can just get really aggressive doing that, say, you know.
Yeah,
title banish two guys, including the Tempest, add a Draugr.
One of the best ways to play around Citalanova Alpha is definitely just to put like a big beat stick on the field and say, look, I'm not going to activate anything. I'm just going to swing your guy and it just completely turns off your trap. Or like with the Wolf play, it forces them to Alpha something that necessarily had been very beneficial at all. Especially in the case of Wolf, where you look at it and like he, interestingly, like due to card text, doesn't get to draw if he negates the effect of a Wolf because cards in the graveyard can't be destroyed.
That is very true.
Yeah, so he would actually neg off doing that as well, which is not great for him.
So it looks like Sean has had a very solid opening here with already having a very large amount of cards in his graveyard, including Dragon Rulers and
a couple of different Lightsworn. And he also has the Wolf and the Lumina on the field. So there's at least three names and a Dragon Ruler, which is a very, very strong start.
So he's just going to put a lot of damage into Hayden on the turn one.
Yeah. No, he's got the Jaynat as well.
I mean, Hayden's start's likely just going to be Deneb set three, set four, and
he's making the Xyz play as well. Goes to the Lavaval Chain.
Lavaval Chain.
Yeah, that just means that Sean basically just gets to toolbox out his entire deck now. Pretty much every Lightsworn card is as useful in grave as it is in hand to him. Sometimes more so with the case of things like Eclipse Wyvern or Dragon Rulers. Lavaval Chain in Lightsworn is like almost as ridiculous as it is in Infernity. Like,
it can certainly feel like it sometimes.
Yeah, you basically just grab whatever part of your combo you're missing to fatly drop three Judgment Dragons on your opponent. And I believe that was a Solemn Warning set as well.
That was a Breakthrough skill, I believe. So we see. Definitely has enough names in Graveyard and a Dragon Ruler and the Eclipse Wyvern. So Hayden is going to need a very, very strong.
He has a Judgment Dragon and a Light Ray Diablos in hand. So this is literally going to be a case of either Hayden has some sort of defensive trap or next turn is going to be very, very rough for him.
This just reminds me, every single time I played Lightsworn in an event, it was my opponent would get three turns.
Yep.
Game 1, I would go first, mill half my deck, kill them turn 2. Then game 1, they would go first, I'd mill my deck turn 2, and then kill them on my turn 2.
Yeah, exactly. That's kind of it. The very frustrating thing that can happen when you play Lightsworn is you're always exactly, even if you lose, you're always one turn away from killing your opponent, because quite often the 6 extra mills or the 1 extra turn to draw is all you really need.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. So,
but yeah, it's very intimidating for Hayden to sort of start his first turn and be staring down a Lavaval Chain that can use its effect, a massive graveyard. He's obviously very aware of the fact that there's a lot of names in there, and a Dragon Ruler and an Eclipse Wyvern. He doesn't know about Sean's hand, which obviously is enough damage to just put game on the board, but in general, it's just not going to be great for him. The Battle Guard Howling here may not prove to be useful at all, considering that Judgment Dragon is just going to wipe out the field.
Just going to be a complete blank against the Judgment Dragon, yeah.
Yeah. Although, really here, there's not a great deal that Hayden could have drawn that's really going to stop this, unless his hand is literally Deneb in defensive traps. Like,
Vanities would have at least stopped him dying this turn. It would have just been a fog, so that would have been fine. He does main deck Vanities, doesn't he? Oh, he sides 3, okay.
That's interesting.
That is interesting. I suppose he does have to make cuts for the burn in his main deck, so not being able to make Vanities is a definite disadvantage, but you know, 4 backers, a non-zero number.
Yeah, again, I definitely feel that his strong advantage was in game 1, where his opponent would have had no idea that he was playing Stellanite Burn. So unfortunately, dropping that game 1 to Sean, just opening very, very well.
And that's just what happens against Lightsworn sometimes. Sometimes you just open God, and there's no combination of cards you could have had in your deck that would have.
Yeah, it just means that by losing that turn 1 advantage, he's now, even if he's sided out most of his Burn cards because he's running the Alsams and stuff, he's sort of now just playing a very suboptimal version of regular Lightsworn.
So we see the standby phase Vanities, I'm assuming.
Yeah.
I respect Hayden enough to play around the inherent summons by just dropping that straight up in the standby.
Yeah, it's definitely a good plan, because once the Judgment Dragon hits the field, the Vanities is not going to help
so
you at all.
So this Vanities right now is basically just saying, you either Wyler me or you lose the ability to be able to kill me this turn.
Yeah, and unfortunately for Hayden, that Larval Chain is strong enough to beat over the Deneb, which then just turns off the Vanities.
True, but he's going to lose every card he has on the field. He has, what, two cards left in hand, including an Altair, but he's not dead.
Yeah, that's
so
that's
it gives it. Him an opportunity to say, you know, next time maybe excite a knight and set another Vanities.
Yeah, that's
and
it.
Just, but even then, there's a lot of draws for Sean as well that could get him out of that. But it really depends. I can't see how many Lilas he's milled. He's milled at least one.
Yeah, there's definitely at least one.
I'm assuming he plays two.
I believe his hand is a Judgment Dragon, a Light Ray Diabolos, and a Tempest. You can see Sean just contemplating what he does. Although at this point, it's a little bit irrelevant since it's really just going to be kill you more.
You know, he just, rather than like trying to win the game here, he just needs to ask the question, how can I possibly lose this game?
Yeah, that's
and
it.
And so he just has to play to not lose. Yeah, I mean, Hayden is so far behind, he's just going to take low percentage plays.
Yeah, that's
that
it.
Might get him there.
Oh, you never say no to the extra guy.
Oh, absolutely not. So, is he probably just going to get Howlinged here? Yeah, which will still do the same job of shutting off the emptiness. But it means that his Deneb is possibly going to live another turn, say if Hayden just, like he has everything, just has another emptiness.
Yeah, it also...
So if he just has the second emptiness here, he could probably just win this game now.
And it's the same deal with Hayden. Like, you know, as much as we're saying Sean's just playing to not lose, Hayden can't just sort of give up at this point. You know, swinging in for that 18 is relevant, because if he can turn around and put a decent amount of burn on board, maybe summon an Alsem into a cowboy. Yep. Oh, of course, yep.
Knowing Hayden has the second emptiness.
Just Natty has a second emptiness, no worries. So that's nice for him, I guess. You know, seeing two opponents where they both sort of opened everything is always really interesting, because at that point it's kind of just like, does my everything beat your everything?
Okay, right. Three more mills that aren't going to help out Sean here.
Yep, it'll be very interesting to see where Hayden goes with this.
Just summoning another Deneb.
Yep.
Which Stratos, makes sense.
Stratos is a very good card. So
quite good, yes.
So he's going to be able to run over that Lumina as well, which is good. Stops Sean applying pressure with it next turn. You know, we may see a shift here where if Sean ends up with a Dragon Ruling Grave, a couple of Judgment Dragons in hand, but no other cards, he's just not going to be able to get over that Vanity's Emptiness, and he could honestly just lose to the Deneb Beats.
He could just lose to the Deneb Beats. I mean, he may not have that many normal summons left in his deck that are above 15. I mean, he's got two Wyverns in Grave. He's milled half of his Light Sworns. I've seen Janes and such. I haven't seen many Raidens, so he's still drawing live, but there's a Lumina. I mean, that's just not going to do it here.
Yeah, so that's it. Unfortunately for Sean, you know, you really do need the outs of those Floodgates. That's obviously why he sides the three Royal Decrees, three MST, and one Malkat, but it's quite possible he either didn't side them in or he just hasn't seen them.
Yeah, and so Sean only has one more draw step here.
Yeah, that's it. If he can't really do anything about this turn, Hayden's just going to be able to drop that other Stellar
Knight. And he has exactly lethal next turn. He can just summon the Altair, and that's 4-7.
Yep. Although, yeah, obviously Sean is able to set that Lumina defensively.
Truth. Okay, so there we see...
Una Con Lai.
Una Con Lai.
I think. We can double-check that, but it really doesn't matter. No one cares. Absolutely no one cares. Hayden attacking with the Una Con Lai first, playing safe, just in case he has something with more than 1500 defense. Not that I'm sure any of the Light Swans do.
He could be playing Genus, but that card is terrible.
He would really have to hate himself quite a lot.
He would have to hate himself and his opponent. Was that a Raiden I see off the top? Shuffled it in too fast for me.
He is definitely considering it. But keep in mind, the issue now is, even though he has the Raiden, a couple of turns have progressed, and now he's staring down not just the sort of Deneb and two irrelevant back row. It's now three monsters and two back row, and if either one of those back row is like a bottomless or somewhere to stop the Raiden, that pretty much takes him out of the game, although I guess then that would kill the Vanities.
So it's possible Hayden just has the third Vanities, knowing him?
Oh yeah, entirely possible. Man does love having everything.
That is very much true.
Now,
I'd also really love it if Sean played in and Hayden just had Needle Ceiling.
Or even like a Magic Cylinder, I think, would be possibly the best thing that could happen right now.
Yep, say he summons Judgment Dragon, he pays the 1,000 as cost, it gets Alfred.
Yep.
And then he just goes, well, I can't do anything else, attack into Cylinder. Either that, or if this Raiden gets cylindered and he just dies, I am going to be...
So he did mill the Dark Hole on and stuff Raiden, which is just great for
which
him.
Is great to know. Yep, and there it is.
Oh, wow, that's...
Hayden the Matthews GG. Have everything.
The Great Burn. That'll do it. It happens. There's really nothing Sean could have done about that. There was absolutely zero way to play around that magic cylinder. Wow, that is definitely a good example of how a very, very unconventional deck can beat a normal deck, I guess. Like, the burn cards there, the mind games as to whether or not he sided them out. He hadn't played any other burn cards that match, but of course,
He just had everything.
Yeah, he just had everything.
He had everything. He had all the tools he needed to win that game, and, you know, Hayden had a very good draw. Sean had a very good draw, but
yeah. Well,
he just had the right cards at the right time, and it just got him out.
Yep, that's it. Sometimes you'll start a game, you'll look at your opening hand and go, yep, great, can't possibly lose, but you've got to remember that your opponent's playing six cards as well.
Shout-outs to J-Had the Watcher, constantly behind us.
Yep, actually the greasiest man on the planet. That inside of that window is going to be opaque by the end of this if he keeps touching it, I swear to God. Look at him, he's terrifying. So we saw some interesting cards. Didn't seem to be a lot of side cards. I know Hayden sided in the three emptiness and just opened two of them because of course he did.
Yeah,
but
just standard him.
Interesting that neither of them, other than the Stygian Dirge from Sean, neither of them sort of saw many floodgates, which seems to be a really defining thing this format. Game two and three, this format seems to be like you just side in whatever floodgates don't hurt you and hurt them.
Yep.
So that's sort of why Satella Knights had a really early advantage, was that Burning Abyss and Shadow both dark decks, so they could just be like, yep, Shadow Imprisoning Mirror, no worries, and it hurt two out of three decks.
Okay, so we have Hayden coming in for an interview.
Oh, excellent. That sounds like good fun.
That sounds like an excellent time.
We can ask him the secret to having everything.
I would love to know. Yeah, we have a couple players here that are like that. We have Henry the Thinking McBriarty, who's also very good at just having everything.
He's good at having everything, and he buffers like YouTube. I've never seen a person do this.
And Hayden plays, he doesn't slow roll you ever, but Henry just slow rolls the having everything.
Yeah.
So it's not just sitting there and being like, man, I could never beat that. It's sitting there for 10 minutes longer than you needed to while he just slow rolls you with absolutely everything.
Which is why we kind of give him a feature, because we'll be here till tomorrow. Yep. Yeah, some good comments going through on the stream from Bodang telling us. That emptiness definitely doesn't last.
Aiden's stepping in.
Whoop.
Make sure I don't kick anything over on my way out.
Please kick everything. All right, so we have our round one feature match winner, Hayden Matthews, here for an interview. So Hayden, tell everyone, what's it like to have everything? So you were playing a very, very unconventional deck. You were playing sort of the Satella Knight engine with the burn. What made you decide to play that as opposed to your headphones are backwards. Seriously. There you go. All right.
So
what made you decide to play sort of a very unconventional build of Satella Knights as opposed to sort of going with like the tried and tested method of just, you know, Deneb plus traps?
Honestly, super polymerization in dolls. Because it's just annoying.
yep.
Honestly, I just kept playing games, and you play it, and you're like, oh yeah, I'm winning this game, I'm playing it right, not overlaying. Then it just goes super poly, construct, send, and beat you.
Yep.
And I was just like, if I can beat them faster, then I feel like that's a better way to do it.
Yeah, that's fair. So you're definitely sort of like, rather than trying to slow roll a deck that is itself good at slow rolling, you decided to just completely subvert the game.
Oh, exactly.
Go for the degenerate burn strategy.
And also after like Hoban's build came out, I was playing Soul Charge.
Yeah.
So if I can resolve a ceasefire or anything when they resolve Soul Charge or make it harder for them to do so,
yeah, that's
I feel like it just gives me an advantage. It puts pressure on them instantly to make plays that they wouldn't otherwise make.
That's it. And if you see the burn early, you sort of cut off their Soul Charge options.
Exactly.
And if you see it late, you can punish them for an earlier Soul Charge.
And honestly, I think I talked to you about this yesterday. I was playing more Magic Cylinders, less Secret Barrels and Justice Earths. I didn't actually see those cards, but Magic Cylinder became dead when they just Shadow Game, send it, pop it.
Yep.
If they do that, hit a Secret Barrel, at least I get something out of it.
Yeah, definitely.
I just need to be able to react it, otherwise, yeah.
And we were just discussing while you were playing your match, you sort of have the real advantage of, because you play sort of a really solid 30-card engine and then 10 or so burn cards, when it comes time to side, you can basically just drop the burn. And if you have 10 cards, you can side in against a matchup, you can just drop the burn and side in 10
exactly
cards.
Exactly right. Just then, I think I sided 7 for game 2, then I realized I probably need a third MST once I saw that dirge.
Yeah.
I honestly didn't expect it coming, but I should have. That's my bad, but...
So, how did you feel about the dirge? Did you think
it for my version of the deck, it doesn't hurt me as bad, because I don't really, if you notice, I didn't overlay. I think I overlaid once for a cowboy all game, and that was really just to, because I didn't want to do anything else.
Yeah, that's it. It seems like you get much more value out of just swinging in with the beats.
Yeah, exactly. Like, they're not very strong, but when you back them up with magic cylinders to keep them alive and that Battleguard hailing to get rid of their monsters, it makes it much easier for you to match up.
Compulsory escape device plus Ring of D is like kind of a good card.
It's pretty good, especially against a window, which is a bad card against me.
Yeah, that's fair.
Okay. I feel bad that I used magic cylinder to win the game, but I had a warning set, I think, I showed, so it really didn't
Sean
matter.
Did Sean show you his hand at all?
I thought I knew there was a JD and a Dibos, and he showed me, it was JD, so, Dibos, everything.
So
he literally won if I didn't flip the vanities and he stand my face.
Yeah, yeah, so turn two, if you hadn't flipped that vanity's emptiness, he would have just straight beat you, because he had about a million names in grave, and so,
I looked at his grave, I'm like, there's like five Lightsworns. Knowing Sean, he will have the JD already.
Yeah.
So I have to do this or lose anyway. So I made, if he can kill it with a Lila, that was my fear.
Yeah.
But the fact that I had the second one, which is pretty sacky, to be honest, but having the second one gave me the freedom to just flip it then.
That's true. And it means that, you know, you can both sort of walk away from it. It was a good game of Yu-Gi-Oh! No one complained they didn't open. You both opened the absolute
that was
stones.
Stones game three. Yeah. I'm like, when he did that, I'm like, I went first here. This game is just over anyway.
No, good.
The fact that I could keep their vanities up was good enough.
So, do you feel that the real advantage from your deck comes in game one when your opponent sort of doesn't really know what you're playing?
Yes,
or do you think the strategy continues? Because I noticed that obviously the winning off the magic cylinder in game three means you didn't entirely side out all of your burn.
I'll be honest, all I sided out for game two was the Justice Earths, because I felt if he's summoning more than a few monsters for that to be relevant, I'm really just losing the game regardless.
Yeah,
it's not going to win me the game.
They tend to drop the one JD, blow the field, then drop the rest.
It's not going to help me when I'm just go like, 500 damage when they just kill me anyway.
Yeah.
All I did, I think I put triple vanities, black, I don't know if you saw, I think black horns, just MSTs to cover any decree or anything, and then can't remember the other card, but sure.
No, that's good. Yeah, we didn't see a lot of side from Sean.
No,
so.
The Dirge was all he had, but I think he had more than one set game two. I'm not sure, but I feel like he had MSTs or something, because he was not using anything, so I don't know.
No, good. Well, it's good to see that a very unconventional first round feature match. And
I didn't see it coming. I'm just sitting there. I'm like, hey, Ben, who's on the feature? He goes, you two will do. I'm like, what?
Good.
I don't want to be on now. I want to be later.
No,
so hopefully I can keep going and get there.
Well,
anyway.
Look, if you make it to the bubble, or if you make it to the top eight, we'll definitely hope to see you again.
All good.
It would be hilarious to see a Magic Cylinder take out the $500 tournament.
I would love to.
I think we'll get actual tears on stream.
I believe so. Imagine if that game three was for the $500.
Oh, that's
Magic
it.
Cylinder
it's,
for
$500. It's definitely one of those cards that
I'd frame it.
You either play around it and make suboptimal plays, or like in that particular situation, there was really nothing Sean could have done, because he honestly had to attack you to try and get the
emptiness
out of the
game.
Even
the second term, first term, and I duality'd into the Howling. He did not have a choice but to try and kill my monster.
Yeah.
And he knew I had it. So either way, I lose the vanities.
Yeah.
And then end of battle phasing, doing it anyway. Just won the game once. Because the risk I took was searching Unicoli first turn instead of searching Altair, because I needed to be able to keep a monster on board. So then if he does attack, I can stay alive.
Yeah.
And my Altair will be dead with vanities anyway.
Yeah. So. All right, good.
Bit
well,
of luck, but
good to see your future work well for you. Hopefully we see you take burn Satellites all the way.
We'll see. The dolls will be the issue, but we'll see what happens.
All right, well, good luck with the rest of the tournament.
Thanks, guys. Cheers.
Cheers, man. All right, well, we'll be back with round two soon, so make sure you stay tuned for that.